Okay, I'm going to talk to you about social engineering. So I am Walter Belgers. I am a lockpicker. I'm president of the Open Organization of Lockpickers. So this is a nice place to make some advertisements for Tool. I'm also a collector of old Sun Microsystem computers. And the last 15 years, I have been working as a penetration tester, and I've also done social engineering assignments, trying to get into corporations using social engineering techniques. So in this talk, I will be talking about what you can do to learn social engineering yourself, and I hope to give you some tips on how to prevent it, although I think that's quite hard to do. So is there anybody here who has read this book? Yeah, okay, there's also a movie. Sorry, that's the movie, this is the book. That's quite an interesting story. It's a good read if you are into social engineering. This is a story written by Frank Abagnale. He is a real person, and he did a lot of social engineering in his day. He was able to fool people into thinking that he was an airline pilot, that he was was working in law, all kinds of things. And he was able to do all kinds of interesting stuff, like fly for free in airplanes, just by pretending to be a colleague pilot. And if you read the book, what will strike you is that this guy was really a charming guy, and he had a way with words, and it was easy for him to get other people to do things for him. And actually, that's the essence of social engineering. It's being that nice guy and being able to talk people into doing stuff for you. Now, you can use this for all kinds of information or manipulation of people, but of course social engineering is also used in computer crime and getting interesting data from other people. And actually, this is a pretty easy attack, of course, and this is a social engineering attack. It is trying to manipulate you into thinking that something has happened to your credit card, and it also gives you the solution. Oh, maybe something has happened. What's the solution? Type in your card and check to see if it's been stolen. Of course, this will end up at the attacker. And well, here's the power of the internet. If only a few people will fall for this, it's still a good return on investment to make a web page like this, of course. So this is a more elaborate social engineering attack, and this is really I like this one. This is a sign that was at the side of the highway in the United States, close to the border with Mexico, and it says, "Be aware that between here and half a mile there will be a narcotics inspection." So this is a social engineering attack. This is trying to manipulate you. Because what will you do if you do have drugs? Exit 107. You'll take exit 107. It was no accident that this sign was just in front of exit 107. And exit 107 was an exit that almost nobody used. There was just one old farm at the end of this road. And in this case, also the police writing a ticket for you. So this is also social engineering. This is manipulating people's minds into doing something that you want them to do. Oh, I don't have... Do we have audio on the... somewhere? Sorry? Yeah, okay, so the recording has audio. Okay, well. So this is also a great social engineering attack. I think there's two things happening here. First of all, the people are really in shock. Something happens that they were not expecting, so they're in shock. And the second thing is a group pressure, or whatever you want to call it, because no, I'll show it again, because no other people are doing something, that makes you more likely to also not do something. So this is called the bystander effect. Make you copy what other people are doing. So everybody's just standing there, and you make the touchdown. And yes, of course, it'll only work once. Probably.
Hard to believe.
Now this is a bit worse without sound, but I'll talk you through it. Who of you knows Darren Brown? No? We now got this Dutch guy who's also a bit of a Darren Brown, Victor Mitz. So those are people that are halfway between magician and social engineer, trying to manipulate people. And Darren Brown has his own channel, and he's done a lot of quite interesting things manipulating people. In this video clip, he is using blank pieces of paper as money.
Hard so to believe, in but in America, I'm not the massive and lovable star
blank pieces
know me
of paper,
here.
Which are in his
I
wallet.
I shall exploit my anonymity and try some daylight robbery
shop,
in the financial capital of the world with a
fish.
Wallet full of blank paper.
So he goes into the
this
shop
a little cheeky.
With his fake money.
But
it's just pieces of paper. It's not fake money. All right, yeah, it's not money at all.
This will be the first time, and I imagine the last, that I've met with these salespeople.
I'd like to buy some
he
of your
salt. He goes into
salt.
The shop, he selects some fish.
There's, yeah.
And he starts talking to the owner of the store, who's selling him the fish. And this is a well-prepared conversation he's having. And he's asking the guy about the subway system and some small talk. And then he says,
you.
Well, you know, I just took
place.
The subway
Thank
and I was
you.
A little bit intimidating with it. But then the other people from New York, they said, oh,
okay,
go
so
ahead, it's
that?
Fine, it's okay. And he's saying these exact words
the,
just at the moment
subway system,
when he's giving the money.
So this is,
so
okay,
your brain gets
it.
The message, it's fine, it's okay, take the subway. And
idea,
he takes
and you,
the money,
where did you
and
live
he actually
this
also gets change in return. And he said, thank you.
Thank you
very
much.
Just a quick show of hands.
Who
of you thinks this is the way it actually happens and it's not staged, this is real? Okay, so who does think this is staged? Okay, that's the minority. Actually, when I first saw this, I also thought it was staged. And if you look at the Victor Mitz movies, you see that a lot of preparation work is not being filmed. And there's a lot of stuff going on that you don't see on the television. But I've changed my mind on this. I think it is actually real. It is possible to manipulate people in such a way. Manipulating people using social engineering techniques can be very, very powerful. Again, we don't have...
It came in the shape
I'll
of
have to talk through all the videos.
In a packet
this is a small
cereal.
Clip about the early hackers.
This guy,
so
right here.
These were the hackers that were hacking the phone
and
system.
If you glue
the
this
freakers.
Hole right here, like this.
This guy is actually has a big problem right now. He's Captain Crunch.
When you blow the whistle into the phone,
welcome at,
a little chink sound. That's the acknowledgement coming
anymore,
in from the other
let's
side,
not go
saying,
into that. This is just to show you about the freaking
armed
that was
with
being
Captain
done.
Crunch
at that time, there was still no World Wide Web, so it was really hard
anytime,
to get information
place,
about the telephone
anywhere.
System.
In fact,
so
one of the things that we used
there
to do
was one guy
to go to the airport, walk along blowing the whistle next to a bank of payphones.
Was actually a blind guy. He had a perfect hearing. He could whistle the noises
their
that
calls.
The telephone exchanges make.
It wasn't just mechanical switches that the phone freaks learned to manipulate.
And
they also became
guy,
skilled
he
at manipulating phone company employees. An art they called social engineering.
Jargon.
Social engineering
to be able
aspect
to get
freaking
information.
Denny was the expert
so
on that.
Not
that's just, a, that's just the ability of going in and talking to people
the,
on the inside
blah, blah,
of the phone company.
Switch.
Making them believe
say,
you're working for
you know,
the phone company.
I'm such and such, and I'm
good
doing something
this
in the,
is, Bob
in the
from the
operating room.
Alpine
this is the
office
guy.
In Phoenix,
and,
Arizona.
Could you please locate for me
a
connection
3-2-B,
and I need to have an
intercept
strap.
On the intercept strap, and then put the strap back on. We can call
all that kind of jargon. The other person on the line.
Well, this is Fresno here. We've got translation error going into your truck here. Could you pull up truck number, this, that, and the other thing? And give me the trunk
so
ID
using
code,
the correct
this, that, and the other thing.
Language
you know, I mean, and
is
the
really key in getting trust. And trust, again, is key to get people to do something that you would like them to do. So the best tip for becoming a social engineer is to become an insider, to get that trust of being somebody who works in the same company. So this is done by preparing information about that company and talk the talk. It's not really difficult. With jargon, I don't mean necessarily really difficult words or stuff. It can be anything that's specific to that specific company. So it could be names of people working there, addresses that the company is in, projects it's working for, suppliers. All that information will help. If I don't call up somebody asking for a password, but I tell them I'm your colleague, such and such, in the vision, here and there, on location, such and such, I have a much higher chance of people giving me that information. These days, with the World Wide Web, it's become really easy to get a lot of information because companies put a lot of information online. This is just some information about me. But for companies, you will find sometimes internal telephone lists. Most companies have stopped doing that because the people get harassed. Maybe an organogram, maybe the places they have offices or customers they might have. And that is all useful information from a social engineering standpoint. Some people go even as far as putting their complete internal network online. There's this great website called ratemynetworkdiagram.com. And there you can upload your network diagram of your internal network, and you can vote who has the nicest internal network. Of course, this is really interesting from a social engineering standpoint. And with the World Wide Web, we can do reconnaissance of, for instance, also the perimeter. So we can figure out where the entrances are, how to get into a building. So we don't need to resort to the techniques that the people in the phone phreaking days had to do, which is dumpster diving, getting information from that was being thrown away. Of course, if you like, you can still do it. But in most cases, it's not needed. Ah, more video with outside.
Yeah, this is Eric Smith and Rich Tanner with Crane Magazine. We're here
really
to interview
that this show,
Jason and Brent.
Only the two pilot episodes.
The team also has a secret
retracted
weapon. A USB
but here
drive
they are doing an attack
files,
on a
phone
diamond
document and a hidden program
in
they plan
Hills
to install in the company's
so
computer system.
This is
one of the
a
first
bit staged,
things Chris and I did when we got into
an actual
the door
diamond seller
was to ask
who
the
agreed to cooperate
to
with this program to get their security tested. So
from
those are the security people,
glass, the receptionist
they are,
doesn't suspect a thing,
now handing
and
over
gladly
the USB stick to
their
the receptionist.
Request.
So they're using social engineering. Hi,
slot
I'm here,
in the front of the
but I have my notes on this PDF file. Could you
thank
please
you
put in your
little
USB
does
stick
know
on your computer and print
the
out this information
secret
for me
program has just downloaded itself
and of course
onto
she does
hard
do that
drive,
and now
and it installs a
this
back
USB stick
into the company's network
home to
once I had the computer system under my control
the
I was able to read
in
all of the company's emails
and he now has a way in to the
corporate dollars
network
the financial transactions
and he starts
I think
perusing
I maybe
the internal network
the security code
figuring out what's on
the
hard disk
alarm system essentially it gives me the same level of access as if I was sitting behind a keyboard at the network.
The other two guys
Ryan and
they
I were looking for things like motion sensors,
the organization
what
because
type
they said they
have,
to do an interview
the general layout.
For,
I
some kind of magazine.
To my memory, how I can walk into that facility and blindly go into
they
any
interview
room.
This
do
owner
you mind if we take some pictures
of this
of it?
Diamond
sure
shop?
Cool.
And they
thank
ask
you
him all
no
kinds
problem
of questions. Of course,
once we
logical questions.
In, even asked if we could take some pictures. They were totally fine with that.
End
they
up
wanted to
in
show
the,
off
the article
stuff
they're
they were
writing,
making.
But they also
hey,
ask
good
all kinds
Eric
of personal
Smith
stuff, like his family
hi,
situation,
so
how long does he
mind
work here, what
other
names of his children. They get all kinds of information.
Awesome. We're here from Crave, and you know our job is to go interview people who are leading the trends, leading the fashion, making the hottest people hotter.
Sounds good.
Tell me about Jason of Beverly Hills.
We
so
are
it's also social engineering. This guy is really happy to tell them all about what
do
he's doing because he thinks he gets
a lot of the hottest names
publicity
you can think of in the industry.
Whatever you want.
Whatever you want. Mostly over
and
the top.
When they're done
shiny,
here, they get
right
back
heavily diamond studded
later that day.
By playing to Jason's ego, Chris cleverly gets him to reveal crucial
diamonds
information about the company's security. And by the end
they
of the interview,
RFID
he's managed
badge
to con
system,
them into revealing personal
the
information,
one,
such as
so
family members,
able to
employee hire dates, and
RFID
even
totally
just walking
thank you
in Boston
and
divulged
all
and
sorts of information.
Swipe,
they talked to us
their
about
RFID
their procedures.
Cards.
They took some
but
pictures with us. They even pointed out some things
system
that we needed to look at,
so
and we were out within
to
about
the code to the burglary system. And that's something that they found on the internal hard disk. So they can disable the alarm. They go to the vault with the diamonds, but then they need to have the combination. And it's a lock with keys, digits. And they can see which digits are used. So they know the four digits, but not the order. And then they remember from the interview the birth date of his children, use that, and they're in. It's a funny story because they actually succeed, and I've talked to this guy, Chris Nickerson. He said that in the first take for the show, they actually got in a much more easy way. They got over the roof from an adjacent organization, over the roof, and they got in. But it was not it was too simple for television, so they had to do it again. So what you can do, this is classic social engineering. You can pretend to be an employee and ask and call the help desk and ask for help. Of course, you would think that a help desk gets a lot of social engineering attacks, so they probably understand that this is something fishy going on, and they will not help you. But you can do it the other way around. You can pretend to be the help desk and call up the end user and say, "Hi, we have a problem today." I've actually done this once, so I just called up somebody with an organization using my own phone with my own telephone number, and I said, "Hi, I'm the system administrator, and there's a problem on your computer. There's a program running that should have ended and is taking up CPU power." And she said, "Oh, so it's getting slower." So I said, "Yes, that's the problem. The program is running under your name. Did something weird happen lately?" Now, of course, something weird always happens if you're using Windows. So she said, "Yeah, last week I tried to turn off my computer and it didn't go off. So I had to use the on-off switch." So I said, "Ah, there's your problem. We can fix it right away. If you give me your password, I'll get rid of the program." "Oh, okay, my password is Monday." "Okay, thank you. If you have anything else, I'll call you again." So it's really, really simple. And in fact, the simpler the social engineering story is, the more successful it's likely to be. Now, I'd like to manipulate people. You can use different strategies, and I'll go into a few of them that I blatantly stole from this book. This book was written by Mr. Cialdini. He's a professor, but this book is not a really boring academic book. It's really an easy read, and he wrote this because he had the problem that people were trying to sell stuff to him, door-to-door salesmen, and he always fell for that. So he thought, why am I falling for this? And that's when he did his research in how to influence people. So one of the things is social proof. If everybody does something, it must be good. So you see this a lot in commercial advertising. Everybody is doing this. You even have these television ads where it says with small lettering, "These are not actors," to make you believe that actual people are doing this. Social proof. That's not really useful for daily social engineering. Scarcity is another one that I don't see how I can really use this in a social engineering attack. But of course, this is used in marketing a lot. If something is scarce, you want to have it. Now, what is useful? One of the things is shortcuts. The way our brain works is that the first time we need to make a decision, we weigh all the arguments and then make our decision. But once we've made the decision, we stick to that decision. It becomes an automated response. We don't have the time to think every day. So once, when we were little, we tasted Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola, and we thought, this one is better, and then we stick to it for the rest of our lives. It's become an automated response. And a few of those automated responses that most people have is, if it's more expensive, if you have the choice between two products, the more expensive is probably better. If somebody has a white coat and says he's a doctor, he probably knows what he's talking about. Those are shortcuts. And we can abuse them in social engineering. So in my previous job, we use this for instance, the attack where you use the USB key and you give people USB keys that contain malware. And that's also sort of an automated response. A USB key is meant to use in your computer. In 99.9% of cases, it works like it should. So it's become an automated response. If you see a USB key, you can just use it. And that's why it's really hard to prevent those kinds of attacks. Here's another one. This is interesting. This is at a hacker conference. And what you see here is this thing you can... Below there are wires that you can use to charge your phone. So it's a free charging station. But of course, it's not just power that goes into your phone, it's also data. So you can actually extract data from your telephone when it's hooked up to the system. And people at this hacker conference were actually using this. But this is also kind of an automated response. This is meant for charging, I can use it. Or ATM machines. You're not going to check each and every ATM machine when you're using it. I must say, I was in Bucharest last week, and there was an ATM machine, and I found out it was easier to just lockpick it than to... this was for a challenge, by the way, so I had permission to lockpick it.
S gaat nu maatregelen treffen om het skimmen van kaartautomaten tegen te gaan. Ze willen metalen plaatjes met noppen op de automaten plaatsen. Die moeten dan voorkomen dat er skimapparatuur opgeplakt wordt. Hoe de platen worden bevestigd, mag het netwerk niet filmen. En of deze metalen plaatjes effectief zijn, is nog maar zeer de vraag.
Maar wij mochten niet filmen hoe die bevestigd werd. Waarom is dat?
Omdat hij niet vast zit.
Wat je hier ziet is een plaat met een aantal grote noppen erop, die het mogelijk maakt om er
created this. There's actually a follow-up of this, but the amount of skimming has really dropped dramatically. So yes, there is a lot of technical stuff that you can do to prevent these kinds of attacks. But in the end, it's still the end user that's using it. So in the end, social engineering is still in some way or another possible. So here's a ATM machine in Las Vegas at a hacker conference again. There is no skimming devices in this ATM machine. It's an entire skimming machine. This is not a regular ATM. Somebody has brought this in. In fact, nobody knew how it wound up there in the lobby of this hotel. And probably it will spit out some money if you put in your card. But in the end, all your data goes to the attacker. So this is not, you cannot prevent this using technical means. And this is totally mind-boggling. This is in a museum. This is a work of art. Baby left by the ATM machine. It's a work of art, and people in the museum were actually trying to get money from this ATM machine. That's how strong this shortcut is in our minds. So shortcuts, one thing. Another thing that works really, really well with social engineering is authority. If you have the correct accessories, so you look like somebody in authority, that will get you very far. Like you can pretend to be somebody from the police or the fire brigade. Or I've walked around in companies and I used to take a big antenna with me. So then they would ask, what are you doing? Well, I'm doing radiation testing. And then it would be fine. There's also something called slice sincerity. That's interesting. Robert Cialdini writes about it in his book. If you are a waiter in a restaurant and somebody asks you, what would you recommend for us to eat? Then you can use slice sincerity. You pretend to be sincere. You say, well, you know, today the steak is not as good as it normally is, but the chicken is really, really great. You should try the chicken. And the chicken is cheaper than the steak. So then they think you are really sincere because you recommend the cheaper stuff. But then the next question is, what kind of wine would you recommend with that? And there you can recommend a really expensive wine. And of course, we are close to Sinterklaas, so Sinterklaas works really, really great as an authoritative figure. So if you want to get in somewhere around December, you can just... Well, there were colleagues of mine at another company who used this trick to get into a bank. So they disguised themselves as Sinterklaas and a few Zwarte Pieten. And they had a big bag with them, with the goodies. And they said, well, we need to get in. Well, what's your name? So I can give you a badge. My name is Sinterklaas. No, I need your real name for the badge. But I'm Sinterklaas. Well, all right, here's a badge. So they got into the room of the management and they emptied the bag, filled it with all the laptops from all the managers, went out again, and nobody knew who they were. So this is really works great. And in the beginning, I told you about this Catch Me If You Can book. And I said, this guy is really charming. Well, charming also works wonders. You need to make sure that people like you. If people like you, they're more likely to help you. And you can actually work on having people like you. People like other people that are physically attractive. Well, that's a bit of a problem. I need a bit of workout to increase my attractiveness. But what you can do is make compliments. And studies have shown that even making fake compliments, where people know that you're making a fake compliment, it still gets them to like you more, right? So if you tell your partner, oh, you look really, really, really nice today, and your partner thinks you're not really serious, it still makes them like you more. Or when you are similar to them, that also works. So how to be similar? You can use similarity in clothing. You can use similarity in body language. Interests. So you start talking to somebody, they say, I just am back from skiing, and then you talk about how you like to ski, even if you don't, that'll get liking. And here's this is a pretty old story, but this is about a guy who stole, what was it, 12 million pounds, 21 million euros worth of diamonds from a bank in Brussels. And the way he did this was create liking. So he went to the bank a lot of times. He spoke to the guards, was really, really friendly, had a nice suit. He gave them chocolates. And then he was allowed to go into the bank by himself. And he stole all those diamonds. And then they found out he had a fake passport. By the way, in the end, they did catch him. But it did work. Reciprocation. If you give something, you expect something back. We see this with Christmas. If you send somebody a Christmas card, you expect them to send you a card in return. Or if you invite people for dinner, they expect you to be invited as well. So the Hare Krishna have abused this or used this to get donations. They give you something for free, no strings attached. But because of the reciprocation, you think you need to do something in return. So this is also used in advertising. How can you use this in social engineering? Well, you can tell somebody, well, you know, I'm from the IT department, and is there any problem you have? We are just randomly calling people to see if they have any problems, and I'll help you with that. And if they do have a problem, and you help them with the problem first, then they are in this mode, and it's easier to get something in return. Now, if you need information, you can just ask for it. But to make it more successful, you can ask for more than you actually want. And then, if you don't get it, ask for the little that you actually wanted. So you ask, you say, hi, I'm John from the accountant. I need a full dump of your whole employee database. I cannot do that. Well, you know, it's just to check if your records are in line with our policies. So, you know, if you have a sample of only maybe 50 people, okay, that'll be fine as well. And if you then get those 50 people, and that's what you were originally after, mission accomplished. Or you can ask for a little, and then more and more and more. People like to be consistent. So if you've once said to yourself, I like Coca-Cola better than Pepsi Cola, you stick to that. It would be weird if your opinions change every day. And you can abuse this in the following way. If you ask somebody not for the information, but first you ask, would you do me a favor? And they say yes, then they have committed themselves to doing you a favor. And it becomes harder, not impossible, but harder to not do you the favor. So then you ask for the stuff that you need. So at this point, you have actually improved your chances. And you can also give a reason. And studies have shown that if you give a reason, the other person is more likely to give in to your wishes. Right? So you can practice this at the local Albert Heijn supermarket. So instead of asking, could I get in front of you? You can ask, excuse me, would you do me a favor? Yes. Could I get in front of you? Or even better yet, excuse me, could you do me a favor? Yes. Could I get in front of you? Because I'm in a hurry. It doesn't matter what the reason is, just the word because triggers something in the human mind that makes them want to help you more. So you can use this to ask for a little and then more and more and more. So if you're going to do this, you also need to do some pretexting. So you need to make up a story. You have to figure out what you are going to, who are you going to be, and why do we need this particular kind of information. And rule number one is make it a simple story. The biggest problem with people doing social engineering is that they overdo it. So you need to have the story ready. The story might be, I'm doing an audit and I need information. I need a sample of your employee database because I'm doing an audit on ISO something, and you really figure out what the story is, what the company is you're working for, what the name of your boss is, etc. But don't spill all the beans in the first telephone call. If you say, hi, I'm that person from that organization and I need the information for this and this reason, that will raise all kinds of red flags. If you just say, hi, I'm from company, I need this information. If they don't believe it, they'll ask, well, why do you need this information? And you can tell them. So if you are, maybe you pretend to be a mechanic and you want to go inside of the company, you're just saying, hi, I'm here to do some stuff with the elevator. Oh, why? I don't know. My boss told me to do this here, so I'm here today. Don't make it too difficult.
Maybe I'll call your cell phone provider and see if I can get them to give me your email address.
So here's a real life example of somebody doing social engineering on the telephone. So the guy is a journalist and he's asked her, she's doing social engineering, to get information about his telephone bill.
Hi, I'm so sorry.
So
she
uses a YouTube video of a baby crying sounds on the background. So this is maybe to create liking. If the person on the other side also has children, they will identify that similarity, and you get more liking.
And I can't remember what email
she's using very simple tricks. So the conversation is really simple. To get that information.
In just 30 seconds,
at gmail.com.
Jessica gets access to my personal email address.
Now, if I needed to add our older daughter on our account so she could call in and make changes, how would I need to go about doing that? You would have to send me a secure PIN through a text message? Yeah, well, the thing is, I don't think I'll be able to receive a text message if I'm on the phone. Oh, I'm not on there either? So I thought when we got married, he added me to the account.
Jess uses my girlfriend's name and a fake social security number.
5127.
To set up her own personal access to my account.
Wait, I'm sorry, so there's no password on my account right now? Can I set that up?
She even gets the support person to change my password.
Thank you so much for your help today.
So she just basically blocked me out of my own account.
I'll get her fed after this.
So with a really simple story, it's quite easy to get in. So I think that if you want to get access to data or computer systems, it's not the way to attack the system itself, but it's much more easy to go for the people behind the system and get them to get you that information. As we saw in this example, we can use all kinds of technical means to make it harder to attack the system, but in the end, it's still people involved. Right? And people still, it's really hard, also because the IT systems are really hard to use. What do you get? People using these kinds of passwords. It's hard for the industry to get people to become really security aware. And I don't think we can ask everybody to be so security aware as that we would like them to be. I'll skip this. All right, so here's an example. If I show this picture to people, everybody will understand what the security risk is, but people still probably are not willing to do something about it. And talk about smartphones, I think that will become a really big problem in the future. I'll have to see, by the way, 10 minutes, I'll go a bit faster through here. I do want to talk a little bit about what can you do about these kinds of attacks, and I think social engineering attacks are really, really hard to prevent. And in fact, I think that for the companies that I did social engineering attacks, well, it always worked. So I don't think we ever had a customer where it didn't work to do social engineering. Well, maybe one scenario doesn't work, but you can try again and again and again. And in the end, you always get in. So what's the use of doing social engineering attacks for a company when the outcome will be we can get in? And of course, it's good to create awareness, but I'm a bit more pessimistic than I was when I started doing social engineering. I think it is impossible to teach people how to prevent social engineering attacks. Right? I can do a awareness session where I talk about the attacks that we've used to get entrance, and people will recognize that, and they will recognize the examples I will be giving, but they will only trigger when those same examples are being used. So if I go in by telling the reception desk that I'm the mechanic for the elevator, then next time, if I use the same trick, they will recognize this and stop me. But if I use a different trick and I tell them I'm a salesman for the coffee company and I have a free coffee machine that they can use for a couple of months to see if they like it, then it doesn't click. So you use a different trick and you still get access. So it's really, really, really hard. So I think, yes, we should do something a little bit about social engineering, of course, to get the low-hanging fruit. But I think more important also is to limit what people can do if they do a successful social engineering attack. So we've done a lot of investigations where we also try to plug into the internal network and see where we can go from there. And in many organizations, if you plug into the internal network, you are domain admin or root in a matter of hours or days. So in combination with a social engineering attack, I think for me, the fastest way to get into any organization in the Netherlands would be to do social engineering to get physical access and then to go on the internal network and get access to all that data. So I think it's important to understand that the network doesn't look like this with a private network connected to the public internet via a big firewall, where you have a coconut that has a really hard shell and is really hard to get into. Well, yes, it's maybe hard to get into, but if you're inside, there's a really soft and juicy middle part that has no inner protections. It's like a medieval city where you have the city walls that need to protect all the buildings inside. And there is a few gates that are protected. But once you're past the gate, you're in. And you can visit any house on the inside. So I think a lot of companies should put more work into segregating their internal network and making sure that if you're in, you cannot get to all the information. So social engineering, I've been talking about mostly telephone stuff, but you, as I said, you can also do it to get physical access. So what you would do is examine the neighborhood, use Google Maps to see where the entrances are or the exits. In some cases, you will have a smoker's entrance. They'll call it an exit, but it's a great way to get in. Using tailgating, walking behind somebody else inside. Or maybe the parking garage has less security than the front door. You can do a little bit of reconnaissance, see when people are going in and out, having lunch, and use that time to get back. Or maybe use that time to walk through the internal building without too many people noticing you. If people wear ID badges, in many cases the badges can be worn with the badge visible or invisible. So in that case, it will probably suffice to have something that looks like a badge, but it's just a white piece of paper. It looks like a badge that has been flipped around. And actually, in all those years, I think I only went to one company where they had the rule that badges are mandatory, must be worn over here. And the badge has two wires connected to them, so they don't flip over. But that's very, very rare. In some companies, you can print the badge on both sides. That would also help a bit. But I've also been to companies where they have badges for visitors only. So you come there, you're a visitor, you get in, and you discard of the badge, and now you're an employee, because the employees do not have badges. So if you do physical pen testing, you also need to have a get out of jail card, right? So it can be the case that somebody figures out what you're doing and wants to hand you over to the police. So it's nice to have some backup plan in case that happens. So have a letter saying who you are, who has approved this, and in what period of time this has been approved. So if you are being caught, those guys can call up the boss and see if it's okay that you're really there. Of course, you also take a fake letter like this, which looks like a letter that says that you're allowed to do this, but it's not official. So that's the first one you show. And if people say, okay, that's fine, go ahead, then that's another remark for the report. And also, if they see the correct letter, they actually have to call up the people, their boss, to see if it is actually real. And it can be simple as this. So this is the one time when we were actually getting in as a elevator mechanic. So I just took some pictures from that looked like something that you would put on an elevator, did a bit of photoshopping. With that under your arm, that's enough to get in. And once you're inside, as I said, you can get access to information. So what you can do is you can walk to the room with the nicest view, because that's where the management will be. And there's all kinds of interesting stuff. You will find interesting stuff on flip-overs, near printers, in desk doors. But I think more worrisome is that you can install some kind of device to get access to the internal network. As I said, access to the internal network, in a few days, you're probably the main admin. So you can use a base station, but you also have these phone plugs that you can use, which connect through the 4G network, and that will give you an entrance back into the internal network. So you put a post-it sticker on there saying, this is a test from the IT department, please do not turn off. So you're sure it will stay put for a month or so. And you have free play. Interesting that not many people dare to talk to you. So if somebody sees me walking there and they don't recognize me, they probably won't talk to me. So they have a fear of being considered impolite. So I always like to teach people that it's not impolite. You can ask somebody that you don't know things in a polite or impolite way, but it's not impolite to question somebody who you don't know. So you can ask somebody, excuse me, sir, I don't know you, you're walking around by yourself, are you here to visit somebody? Can I help you get to the correct person? So that is very polite. And if he is not supposed to be there, maybe you can figure that out. So what we normally also do is make pictures of stuff that we see and get out. And sometimes getting out is hard if there is really physical access control. In most cases, getting out is the easiest to do. So this I already talked about, the get out jail card. It's also interesting to know if the incident is reported, so we can report back on that. And some examples. So here, this was, I cannot show you photos that actually tell you a lot because it's confidential, of course. But this was for a company that was in a building that housed several companies. And we did some investigation on the internet and we found out that there were mice in the company or in the building. So the people had a problem with mice. So we just called up the company saying, hi, we're exterminators. And we are there to check for how many mice you have. And oh, well. And of course, then you're really, really welcome because they have a problem and they want you to fix it. So we got in and we said, well, we need to get into access to every room. Also the computer room. Yes, there can be mice in the computer room as well. And we were in. Well, this was a company where there was a reception desk that had two functions. First of all, customers of that company could come there and ask stuff at the reception desk. But also it was a reception for visitors getting in. So they were really well trained on not allowing people to just walk into the building because they had all kinds of customers coming there. So we went in being the mechanic, the elevator mechanic, and we were allowed in because we could only get in if the rule was that somebody needed to pick us up at the reception desk. So there are ways around that, of course. You can just apply for a job, for instance, do a job interview, and then you are allowed in. But we decided to be an elevator mechanic, so there would not be anybody to pick us up. So we were allowed in, and we walked inside of the building, and we saw things like this, where this room has the door. There's a cello tape on the door to keep it open, because they actually had more secure parts of the building that we were not supposed to get access to, but the security systems were circumvented. Now, that's something you also see quite a lot. As I said in the introduction, I'm also the president of the Open Organization of Lockpickers. I've also done some physical pen testing stuff, but that's a whole different topic altogether. But also there you see that if you try to get physical access to a building, in most cases it's human error that allows you to get access. So once I needed to get into a building for the Dutch critical infrastructure, and the building had really good locks, and it looked like it should be impossible to get in using lockpicking techniques, but I pushed the door and the door was open. It did not fall shut into the lock. So human error still helps a lot. Now you can also do social engineering, of course, using email. That is what phishing is. And so you manipulate people into clicking a link or going to a website and filling in information. And of course, if you really want to be successful, you use spear phishing. Your story is tailored to the person you're targeting. So you can do all kinds of stuff, getting information, ask for information. But in most cases, what we would do is ask them to log on to a website using their company credentials. I'll skip this. Yeah, let's skip this. And here's an example I would like to show you. What we also did is sending people actual physical stuff that has a USB connector that people would put into their PC. So there is a rat race going on in protecting PCs to not accept strange USB devices. But in most cases, this will probably still be successful to some extent. So in this case, we bought a USB robot. That's actually a USB hub. And we opened it up. And in here, you see the actual USB hub. And we bought a Teensy, which you can see on the top right, which is actually a small microcomputer that you can program. And we put that in, sacrificing one of the USB ports, and closed it up. And now for the Teensy, you have this HID attack vector. There's actually software on the internet, the social engineering toolkit, that you can use to build stuff to program onto the Teensy. So it behaves like a keyboard. And you can program it to become a keyboard, if you have a USB device, it will announce itself as being of a specific vendor and a specific product code. If I know that a certain company is using, for instance, HP systems with HP keyboards, I can program the Teensy to pretend to be an HP keyboard to improve the chances that it will be recognized as such. And you can do this to do an attack. So let me see if I can actually do that. Okay, let me check if you see what I am seeing. Yes, so what you see is a virtual machine running Linux. This is, Backtrack, or Kali, as it's now called. So this is a machine of the attacker. This machine is somewhere on the internet waiting. This attacker then sends the USB device via mail to an unsuspecting target. So we'll have to start a virtual machine for the target. So the target is using Windows 10 in this case. And he plugs in the device. Why is my screen gone? The computer restarted because of a problem. Yeah, I didn't give it away. I upgraded my Mac to High Sierra, and I shouldn't have done that. I downgraded. While my PC is booting, I don't think I have the time to show the full demo here, but we can do it later on in a smaller group. But there's also stuff like this, which is really interesting. This is just a Raspberry Zero, and a guy called Sammy Kamkar has written some software that's really nice. If you plug this into a PC, this thing will emulate a USB Ethernet adapter. And even if your system, I don't know if systems have been changed to prevent this from happening, but when he invented this, systems would then use DHCP to set up the interface. This would reply, with a DHCP answer, and it would say that all of the internet would be behind this little thing. So all your traffic then flows through this device. And even if your system is still in locked, so the screen is still locked, then but you have a browser running, browsers occasionally still make, or pages still make connections to the internet, which will go through this device, and this can then intercept all kinds of interesting credentials. Oh. So what to do? Well, actually, it's stating the obvious, right? So we all know what to do, actually. I think we cannot really prevent users from being susceptible to social engineering attacks. If the story is good enough, it will always work. So the best thing you can do is do some patching on your internal network, look at where your bugs are, and try to compartmentalize your internal network. So in case something does happen, you limit what the attacker can do. So one thing I do find important, something that I can tell people who are afraid of social engineering attacks, is to listen to your stomach and your brain. So sometimes when you are being social engineered, you feel something happening in your stomach. It doesn't feel right. So somebody is calling you up, asking for all kinds of information, and you feel, And learn to recognize that signal and do something with it. And that could prevent a social engineering attack. In some cases, this signal is too late. You hung up the phone, and then your brain starts working, and you start to realize, what did I just do? And then maybe it's still not too late to do something about it. Right? If you are too late, you've already entered your credentials into the website, you can still change your password to prevent further damage. So it's quite hard. Also, you want to be kind, but not too kind. You need to be paranoid, but not too paranoid. It's really hard. We don't want this to happen. I mean, if you're in the human resources department, yes, you have to open emails from people you don't know who have attachments with their CV. So you can't really expect those people to not open any emails with attachments. So it's finding that balance. If you want to do a bit of further reading, you can read the book by Cialdini, which is a nice book to read. But this is even better, Hacking the Human, book by Ian Mann. So if you're interested in social engineering, give this book a read. And I'll just leave it to that. I have only 1 minute left, so maybe we have time for one question. Have you been a victim? Have I been a victim? Well, if it was a good attack, I probably won't know. I've once been in an attack where somebody has social engineered me into buying something I didn't want to have. So yes, but I do believe if the story is good enough, yeah, nobody is immune for this attack. Okay, I think my time is up. So thank you very much for listening.